Liam, thank you for that lovely introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be able to share some time with you today and to go over some of my homework with you. I see you have a very interesting book here. It's a short book. It's readable. It has a lot of charts in it. Maybe I'll give you a sort of a prequel to it, so you get an idea of what might be in there that you might like to delve into a little bit more sometime, perhaps. We live in a time that's called the information revolution, and I know all of you hear a lot about big data. But for all of this revolution and this big data thing, there are a lot of problems in our country that still seem to manage to hide in plain sight. And the reason that problems hide in plain sight with all of these magnificent informatic tools that we have is, of course, because people aren't asking the right questions. I'm going to be talking today about a problem that has hidden in plain sight in our country for many, many years, and has worsened for many, many years, indeed over the course of all of your living existence. It's a little bit harder to hide the problem since, let's say, Wednesday, November 9, 2016, because the elephant in the room kind of like came into Technicolor at that point. But I'm going to show you a little bit of background to help explain why some recent things have happened in our country that have shocked and astounded so many of my friends and contemporaries who are within what my colleague Charles Murray refers to as the bubble. I'm sure you all know what the bubble is. Many of you have probably taken the bubble test. If you haven't taken the bubble test, Google it. It's a lot of fun. So if somebody were to ask, how's the American economy doing today? I know you've had Diane in here already, and she's tremendous. She's wonderful. But if you were to ask somebody, how is the American economy doing today, you couldn't get a single unambiguous answer, which is quite strange, because there are three different disparate answers, depending upon which trends you look at. That's a quite unusual circumstance for any nation, but I'll show you what I mean. Let's see if we can. Does that work? Yeah, there we go. If you were to look at U.S. wealth holdings, at the generation of private wealth in our society since the year 2000, it's been a fantastic success. Admittedly, we had a little oopsie around the year 2008 and a great recession, but you can see that it came roaring back after that. Since the year 2000, the United States has added two full Chinas worth of wealth holdings to our ranks. That's China today, two full Chinas today to our wealth holdings. There's nothing in the world like our engine for generating wealth. Nothing, anywhere. And if that was all that mattered, you know, I could say thank you very much and we could go home very happy right now. But it's not all that matters. And I'll show you a second way of reading where we are. Okay. Instead of looking at wealth holdings, we could look at what's called the real economy, the generation of goods and services in our society, the gross domestic product. And if we look at that, we've got a much less happy story. Since the year 2000, the American economic engine has shifted gears, and it shifted gears downward. And we've got a new and much slower normal. And if you look at this chart here, you can see that the divergence from long-term trend didn't just happen with the Great Recession. It was already beginning before the Great Recession. If we had only kept on the previous trend, on the trend line from 1950 to, say, the year 2000, our country would be generating 20% more output per person today. You know, and even among friends, 20% is a lot. So that's the second reading on where we are. And so if we're doing a fantastic job on wealth generation and what might charitably be called a mediocre job on economic growth, I mean, look how weak the snapback has been since the Great Recession. We've been doing really miserably on job creation. This is a chart that shows how miserably we've been doing about employment creation. It's what we'd call the work rate, the employment to population ratio for the 20 and older population in our country. And it's, I don't know if you ever saw those old television commercials, "Help, I've fallen, I can't get up." But this is kind of where we are. This thing down there, that miserable thing, kind of like in the last half of the graph, that's what we call our recovery and expansion. That's the recovery and expansion that we're in right now. If instead of that sort of a recovery and expansion, if we had gotten back to where we were in the year 2000, we'd have almost another 10 million paying jobs for men and women in our society today. Just think how different our country would be today with another 10 million paying jobs. That's where we are in the 21st century. And as you will appreciate, if you have a situation where there's more wealth for the wealth holders than ever before and less work for the workers, you are framing an almost perfect stage for a populist storm. And guess what happened? You know, what a surprise, what a surprise. Okay, so that's kind of where we all find ourselves. But that work profile that I showed you actually looks even worse the more you pick at it. This shows you the post-war trends in work rates for guys and for girls, for men and for women of so-called prime working ages, 25 to 54, they're called the prime working ages for obvious reasons. Those are also the ages during which people are forming families and raising kids, so it's doubly important. The gray line is for women. I mean, women have been working since the beginning of time. It's only since the end of World War II that they've generally gotten paid for it. And you can see how that went up very strongly, and then it's been stagnating and going down. So we've got trouble in River City for America's women here too, folks. But the long-term worrisome trend is for guys, the blue line. You can see that there was a kind of no particular trend for the first decade or so after World War II, and then is this relentless downward ratcheting of the percentage of men in our country in prime working ages who've got paid employment. I'm going to flip that around and show you. This is the percentage of guys of prime working age from 48 to now who have no paid jobs, guys in the civilian, non-institutional population. The job eligible population. And you can see from, let's see if this thing works. Yeah. From about 1965 to now, we've had this relentless ratcheting up. And at the worst depth of the Great Recession, about 1 in 5 working age, prime age guys had no paid work. And today, it's about 1 in 7. 1 in 7 prime age men has no paid work. And if you were to ask me, Nick, how does that compare to the past, I might be able to tell you. You don't have to, you know, get eye strain on this. I promise I'll tell you what it really says. We don't have much in the way of job information from before World War II, because our modern employment system of numbers, job statistics, wasn't really released until 1947. So if we go before World War II, we have to look at population censuses, which are taken every 10 years. But we can look at the 1940 census, which is at the tail end of the Great Depression. And if we look at that, whether we're looking at prime working age guys from 25 to 54, or a broader measure of guys from 20 to 64, whatever, the work rates today for American men are lower than they were in 1940. I use in this book, I use 2015 as a convenient benchmark because I measure that against 1965 for a 50-year trend. But if we were to look at just like last month's figures, they're still lower. They're lower today. They're lower last month than they were in 1940. So when Nick says to you that our male work situation is of a depression scale, of a Great Depression scale, it's not fake news. There are facts to back this up. It's a very, very serious situation. However, there is a difference between the work situation for men in the Great Depression and today. Back in the Great Depression, there were really only two options, employment options for working age men. Either you had a job or you were looking for one. This is to say you were unemployed and looking for work. We have another option in modern America, and that is to be out of the game altogether, to be out of the labor force, not in labor force, neither working nor looking for work. And that has been the absolutely fastest growing component of the male working age population for 50 years. For 50 years, the guys who are neither working nor looking for work have been growing in numbers three times as fast as our prime age male population overall. And for those of you who have taken math, and I'm sure you've all taken math, you know that if you do something three times as fast as something else for 50 years, you change the world. And I'm going to show you how the world has changed. That blue line is the total head count for prime age guys in the post-war era, month by month, who were unemployed but looking for work. That gray line is the total head count of prime age guys from the beginning of the post-war era who are neither working nor looking for work, not in labor force. And you will see that those two lines have not intersected for 25 years. Okay. Even during the worst months of the Great Recession, which you may barely remember, even during the worst months of the Great Recession, there were more guys checked out of the labor force than unemployed and looking for work. And today, if you compare those two things, there are three times, actually more than three times, there at least three times as many guys who are checked out of the labor force, neither working nor looking for work, as unemployed and seeking jobs. So, among other things, this means that when you hear happy talk on the news about how the unemployment rate is going down, you're looking at a quarter of the problem, right? You're chasing the wrong rabbit. You're fighting the last war. Unless you look at the flight from work, at the exodus from the workforce, you don't have a clear picture of what is ailing our labor economy and our families. Now, this is not my contribution to modern art. There's a meaning to this chart. And what you really only have to pay attention to is that dark, jagged line that wins the race to the bottom down there in the lower right-hand corner. That is the workforce participation rate for prime-age American guys in comparison to all other rich countries over the last 50-plus years, against never-communist Europe, Japan, Canada, Australia, New Zealand. We have won a race we really don't want to win. And it is somewhat curious, and we'll get back to this thing, but it's somewhat curious that we have won this unwelcome accolade, because after all, we have not suffered a lost generation of growth the way Japan has. We do not have a dirigiste, sclerotic labor market and the suffocating welfare state like, say, France has, and we're not Greece. But yet, somehow, we're down there. So we have to figure out what's going on here. It's a real and serious question. if we, there are 7 million guys today in this 25 to 54 year old pool of neither working nor looking for work people. And if you have 7 million people in a pool, you're going to have some of everybody. But some are overrepresented. If you look at our ethnicities, African Americans are overrepresented in this pool. But while we're talking about people of color, Asian Americans and Latinos are underrepresented. They're more likely to be in the workforce than the national average. The educational gradient, I think, is probably pretty much the way you'd imagine. High school dropouts way overrepresented. College grads and people with graduate degrees way underrepresented. When it comes to marriage, guys who have never been married, whether they have kids or not, are way more likely to be in the pool than guys who are married. Guys who are married are way less likely to be in this NILF pool. And with respect to what the Census Bureau calls nativity, which is not a Christmas scene, nativity meaning where you were born in this country or abroad, guys who are born abroad are way more likely to be in the labor force than guys who are born in this country, all other things being equal. But we do not live as helpless victims of social probability functions. There is something called human agency, human will, and individual responsibility, which is at play as well. And I'll show you about that a little bit. Okay, so you remember I just said that African Americans are more likely to be out of the labor force than the rest of the country. That gray line there is black guys who are married. The white line is white guys who were never married. And so if you'll permit me the verb, we see that race trumps, that race is trumped by marriage in this particular case. Marriage overcomes this ostensible ethnic differential. And we all know about education and the advantages of education, but you can't tell which of these two lines is which, right? They're just about identical. One of those lines is married guys who have no high school degree, married high school dropouts. The other one is never married college grads. Somehow marriage is an equalizer in this situation, okay? It isn't because this is magic or like has some sort of magic in it. It's because it comes with a whole constellation of attitudes and beliefs and outlooks and behaviors. And those have an enormous impact on outcomes. So people's behaviors, beliefs, attitudes, and outlook have a huge impact here as well. When I started doing my homework for this book, I read all the stuff that labor economists and experts in Washington were saying about this problem. And much of what they were saying is that it's a problem of technical and structural economic change. Globalization, decline of manufacturing, outsourcing, big drop in demand for less skilled workers. And all of that is true to a degree. But if that were true, the most globalized place in the world, which is probably Switzerland, would have a worse work profile for men than we do, and it doesn't. So there's something else going on. And I'll give you three examples to kind of prove that I think that other things are going on as well. This is Exhibit A for the defense. This shows the percentage of guys checked out of the labor force in this 25 to 54 year old group over the period from 65 to the present. And if you, any of you have done stuff in the social sciences, social science statistics, econometrics, you know that human beings are incredibly poorly behaved. I mean, they're irregular, you know, they never line up properly and stuff. This is what I would call a social science straight line. I mean, it's just about as close to a straight line as you get in looking at the untidy social sciences. And if you look at this almost regular exodus from the workforce for over 50 years, you can't see where the Great Recession was. You can't see where the previous five recessions between the Great Recession and 65 were. You can't see where China joined the WTO, or where we joined NAFTA, or where iPhones came in, or any other disruptive technologies. This is not a story of demand shocks. There's something else going on. And as for the decline in demand for less skilled labor, of course, there's truth to that. But one of these, both of these groups are high school dropouts, male high school dropouts. This is their workforce participation rates, okay? The one at the top is foreign-born high school dropouts. The one doing really badly at the bottom is US-born high school dropouts. They're both without high school degrees. If there is some sort of universal decline in demand for less skilled labor, I don't see it here. And then there's this one. This is one of the most vexatious problems. I was admittedly trained in economics slightly after the Stone Age ended. And so, but back then, what they taught us was that if there was a shock to a market system, markets would seek equilibrium afterwards. Markets seek equilibrium. They go back towards being kind of more like the same. This is the percentage of men not in the labor force in this prime age group across our country in 2015, state by state by state. And those of you who know statistics will understand what I'm saying, and the others of you will have to trust me. What has happened since 1980 is that the differences at a state level have increased year by year by year. They haven't come together the way that equilibrium is supposed to happen in markets. And to make matters even more peculiar, some of the states with the worst profiles here are adjacent to some of the states with the best profiles. So West Virginia is over here, and you know, we know the sad West Virginia story. But West Virginia shares a land border with, let's see, where are we? Where is Maryland? Help me find Maryland.
Right next to the Dakotas.
Dakotas, okay. Okay, so yeah, thank you. So Maryland is here, and Virginia is here. So the very worst is next to two in the happy side of the chart. And when I was in third grade and took Mrs. Parker's geography class, they taught me that Maine shared only one land border in the United States with another place, and that was the state of New Hampshire, and I think that's still true. And so what? So there are no U-Hauls? I mean, how can this be? There's something else going on. I'll show you one of the things that is going on. One has been the explosion of disability lifestyle of people out of the workforce and supported at least in part by government disability programs. According to our Census Bureau's survey called SIP, Survey of Income and Program Participation, in most recent wave they've done, they're always a bit behind, we're looking in the rear view mirror, almost 3 in 5 of the prime age guys not in the workforce were on, reported being on one or more disability program. And if you know it's a survey response answer, it means that probably it's more than 56 or 57% if God was measuring this, right? And 2/3 live in homes that receive at least one disability payment. Now, disability does not allow you to live a princely lifestyle. It's rather penurious. But it does provide an alternative to the world of work. So I cannot say, and nobody can prove, that the advent of disability insurance and its usage in this way has caused the problem. But it incontestably has financed the problem. And here is the saddest chart I think you will see on your time in Washington during this conference. It shows the percentage of prime age men not in the labor force in different government programs by educational status. So for instance, here, we see that high school dropout guys are 75% likely to be on one or more disability benefit, and high school graduates with no college are almost 60% likely, and so forth. Disability benefits establish your eligibility to be in a low-income health program run by the government called Medicaid, which I'm sure some of you have heard of. And you can see that almost 80% of the high school dropouts and almost 60% of the guys just with high school are enrolled in and receiving benefits from Medicaid. We have to connect the dots between the Medicaid program and the explosion of the opioid epidemic over the last two decades. You know today that more people in our nation are dying of drug overdoses than of car crashes or of gunshots. How did this happen? How did this happen while we were looking? How did this happen in plain sight, hiding in the corner of the room over the course of two decades? I'll tell you one of the many reasons, but it's an important reason. Since the change in thinking about pain pills about a generation ago, it's been possible for somebody who's enrolled in Medicaid to go to a pain pill factory and to get a script from a pain pill doctor there that prescription for 90 OxyContin for a month, and they'll pay $3 out of pocket for that. Who pays for all of the rest of it? Uncle Sam, or rather, all of us, through the Medicaid program. The Medicaid program subsidizing the mass distribution of opioids in our country. And so I guess you could say, if you had a penchant for gallows humor, that this brings a new meaning to dependence upon government. And I'm afraid that it has. We are now starting to deal with this. We are now starting to grapple with this at the state level, but it's been a disaster that's been hiding in plain sight for these same two decades I've been describing. We'll get to the end of this. When I was doing this book, I suspected that criminality, crime and punishment, had something to do with this collapse of work for men I was describing to you. So I looked in the statistical yearbook for the chapter on, you know, what the work rates were for guys with felony convictions in their background. And it turned out there isn't any chapter in the statistical abstract on that. And then it turned out that the Census Bureau doesn't collect any information like that at all. And then it turned out, as I looked further, that the Bureau of Justice Statistics and nobody else collects this information. So people who have had a felony in their background are kind of invisible to our record collectors. Some of my brother defiant nerd demographers decided that they were going to try to reconstruct the trend lines for total felon population in our nation. I think they did a pretty good job. By the year 2010, in their estimates, nearly 20 million living American men and women, obviously overwhelmingly men, had a felony in their background. If we were to extend this series to today, it would probably be something like over 23 million for sure. You've all heard of mass incarceration. You know that about 2.5 million people are behind bars. That's 2.5 million out of 23 million. Do the math. Over 20 million people, overwhelmingly men, have felonies in our society and are not behind bars. Do the math a little further. That means about 1 in 8 adult guys who's not behind bars has a felony in his background. And we can guess that maybe, just maybe, this has some relation to this work deficit that we've seen. I couldn't find any government surveys which would elucidate this or illuminate it, but I did find one, and again, this is my last bit of homework to show you. You can take my word for it, it's in the book, but I promise I'll tell the truth about this, what this stuff shows. Doesn't matter a guy's age, doesn't matter his ethnicity, no matter his educational background, if he's been to prison, he's way more likely to be out of the workforce than if he only has an arrest. And if he only has an arrest, he's way more likely to be out of the workforce than if he's never been in trouble with the law. I can't tell you why this works this way. I can tell you that it does work this way. So we have an enormous problem in our midst. To summarize, there's no good in any of this men without work thing that I describe in this book. The men without work thing means that our country is growing slower economically than it would otherwise. It means we have larger economic gaps and wealth gaps than we'd have otherwise. It means we have more welfare dependence than we'd have otherwise. Probably means we have larger budget deficits than we'd have otherwise. It means more pressure on fragile families. It means less social mobility. And for reasons I can explain, it also means a weaker civil society. My objective in writing this little book was to try to put a spotlight on something that's been out of the public eye for far too long. And your charge, not just now, but I think as you mature, as you start families, as you raise families, as you become productive members of our society, will be in your own ways to address this problem, to help turn it around so that this plague won't affect future generations the way it is affecting our country today. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to address any questions you may have. Liam, how do you like questions to work? Do you
we'll just have people come up to the
okay,
mic,
fine.
Say what school they go to,
sure.
What their name is, and
yeah.
Hey, Alex Clark, Cornell University. The concept of a universal basic income is becoming ever more mainstream in the public discourse.
Yeah.
It's even been implemented in a limited extent in places like Finland and Canada.
Yes.
And it's being discussed more and more here in the U.S. How does that factor into this whole debate and this analysis you've set forward here today?
I'm glad you asked about the universal basic income, because that is a very important question. It is being increasingly discussed and seriously discussed. At my institute, my friend and colleague Charles Murray is a big proponent of UBI. We do have a few intramural disagreements, friendly disagreements at our institute, and I'm going to outline why I disagree with Charles and with other people about this. And my reasons do not have to do with the feasibility of financing UBI, which is another matter altogether. I will tell you, my reservations have to do with what happens to people who don't have work as a vocation. I have a little chapter in that book which tries to answer the question from the time they wake up until they go to sleep. What do these guys who are neither working nor looking for work do? It's not a happy portrait. Of course, this is self-reported time use surveys. And if you remember a show called Dr. House, M.D., Gregory House's adage was that everybody's a liar when they come in. So this is not perfect, but let's say it's good enough for government work. When we take a look at the self-reported time use for guys who are out of the workforce altogether, what do we see? Basically, they don't do civil society. They don't do worship. They don't do volunteering. They don't do charitable work. Although they've got nothing but time on their hands, you might think, they do surprisingly little help with children, help with other people in the household. They do less cleaning and chores around the house than employed mothers, who are like the most time-scarce people in the universe. What they do, by their own report, is they watch. They watch videos, DVDs, internet, TV, handheld devices, what am I leaving out? And they do it for about 2,100 hours a year. I mean, a full-time job is 2,000 hours a year. So this is, akin to, couch job. And to make matters even more problematic, last year, the former head of the Council of Economic Advisers, Alan Krueger, from Princeton, came out with a report saying, again, by self by self-reporting, that almost half of these guys in the unworking pool self-reported taking pain pills every day. So what we're describing is not just like World of Warcraft 24/7 or 8 hours a day. It's a World of Warcraft stoned. And so there is a whole question about the quality of citizenship that I think comes up with UBI. Economists are all too often falling into the trap, the intellectual trap, of calling free time leisure. There is a distinction between leisure, which is using your time for elevating purposes, leisure as the foundation of civilization, Joseph Pieper and all that sort of stuff, and idleness, which has very different implications. So I am troubled by the implications of UBI for citizenship, and that's entirely apart from the financeability of it. I realize that we may be coming up to great technological disruptions, and this will be talked about more, but we need to have more serious discussions of the pros and cons of the question. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Adam Brown from Southern Methodist University in Dallas, Texas. I had a question about underemployment. So you talked a lot about having a job and not having a job. At any time in your studies, which were very detailed, I must say, any time in your studies, did you find people who were underemployed or in places where they weren't being utilized to their full extent? And if so, how can we as a country change our foundation and try and help people like that find better and more fulfilling employment?
Now, the excellent question. Thank you for asking that. Yes, I was looking at men who were checked out of the workforce altogether. As you know very well, there are different measures of employment. The U3, you're talking more about like the U6. so there certainly are people in our country who report that they do not have as much opportunity to work as fully as they would like. That would seem to suggest one of two things: either inadequate demand for labor or barriers to working. You could also, I suppose, make the argument that it's a supply problem, they should be willing to work for less, but let's leave that aside. So one of the institutional problems that we can mention is already here, is having a felony in your background. If you have paid your debt to society, maybe you can repair your employment reputation gradually, but maybe that is hard in some places, harder than in others, for institutional reasons. There can be other sorts of institutional barriers, such as licensing and other sorts of cartelization of employment opportunities, and those are not negligible. They vary across the nation, as you know, by state and by locality. There's also the whole question of the general lack of demand, generation of jobs. And I would say that that relates very directly to the weakness we see in small businesses in America today. The percentage of business startups in relation to all businesses existing has been going down in almost a straight line for 40 years. And I can't presume to explain exactly why that is the case, but it seems to me quite reasonable to suggest that this has something, at least something, to do with the increasing tax and regulatory burden that small businesses are suffering under throughout our country, not just imposed by Washington, D.C., but also at the state and the local level. Healthy generation of jobs depends upon a healthy small business sector. I mean, Apple's wonderful. I mean, I've got an iPhone here. Amazon's great. I use Amazon all the time. The jobs that Apple and Amazon create in our labor force are a rounding error. The real bulk of jobs in our society are created by mom-and-pop businesses and small businesses. And until we have a healthy small business environment, I don't think we can count really on having the underemployment problem go away.
Thank you.
You talked a lot about the variation between states in the aftermath of 2008. Something that I find interesting is the recent trend in migration away from places like California towards Texas and Florida. Two states which, despite the administration's last administration's best efforts, have created more jobs than the rest of the states combined.
Sure.
Do you expect this trend to continue? And if so, what can states like New York and California do to catch up?
Well, you know the answer to that question. You want me to say it? Sure. I mean, you all know the answer to that question. Until the laws of economics are suspended, you want to have a more competitive and business-friendly environment. I've done a little bit of homework in this book on trying to map out the size of the welfare states, or at least the size of the welfare benefit packages in different states, against this thing. The correspondence is very poor. It's a very weak relationship. I think that part of the reason for that is because the social welfare state archipelago is so arcane and difficult that welfare state benefits are not terribly portable from one state to the next. People don't try to move in that sort of a manner. I do, however, show that we've got a natural experiment that's going on in our country. If we look at foreign-born Americans, if we look at immigrants, compare them in high welfare and low welfare states. Look at California, which is almost as close as we get to Europe in terms of social welfare treasure chest. Texas is Texas. Compare California and Texas, and look at the Latin American migrants who come in. It's exactly what I would expect. Workforce participation rate for Latino immigrants to California is lower than in Texas. TANF benefits, higher than in Texas. Disability dependents, higher than Texas. So we have a natural experiment that I think confirms what you're describing. Two other things I'd mention about this. One is that the job generation situation in much of rural America is really grim right now. It's really grim. And I can show you maps of this around the country. It's not just in a few states. It's characteristically grimmer than in urban areas. The other thing I would mention about migration is that it has generally been declining for 35 years. The move rate, whether you're moving next door, in next county, next state, the percentage of movement is half as high today as it was in the mid-80s. Why is that? Well, some of it may be job generation and the lack of churning I was describing. Some of it is when you're tethered to local social welfare benefits, you are less likely perhaps to move someplace else in seeking opportunity. And if one in eight adult guys has a felony in his background, I mean, a fair number of them are under current correctional supervision, it's kind of hard to say to your parole officer that you'd like to look for a job in Hawaii, right? I mean, so all of these things are pressing down on movement, and migration is one of our best answers to trying to jumpstart this situation.
Great, thank you.
Hello, Thomas Olson from Masters University. Early on, you showed a graph that had the male participation in the labor force declining and the females increasing. Could it be that females are taking the jobs that men once held, and what's the connection there?
Excellent question. And that was one of the first things that I wanted to look at here. Now, There is one line that I erased from this chart in the interest of simplicity, and that is the total national work rate average. Okay, and if we had that total national work rate average, it would have looked something like this. It would have started, let's say, about here. It would have gone up to here, and then it would have gone down like that. Now, the national average work rate went up for like 50 years. That means that if we were in a situation where women were just replacing men, it would be flat. But instead, we had this rise in national work rates. So that suggests that women were augmenting, on the whole, augmenting male work rather than replacing it. Since the year 2000, we've had a decline for men and a decline for women. So I mean, women and men are both sharing the same pain. I don't think that the decline in work rates for women over the last 15, 20 years is because we're having a lot of people staying home and having babies. It's not happening. So neither when the rates were going up for women, nor when the rates more recently have been going down for women, can we account for most of this change as being a displacement of guys. I recognize that there's certain sort of work that's maybe more guy-friendly, like heavy manual physical labor. There are jobs which people think are more girl-friendly, more caring, I guess. Education, health, that sort of stuff. But if you look at the overall employment statistics, there's a lot of turnover for both men and women in all of these, and I think that. There's a lot of reason to think that there's a national labor economy as well.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kenny Hsu, Davidson College. I want to talk about diet. So
yeah.
There's this idea about diet and physique and how that affects men. And obviously, there's this increasing obesity epidemic right now.
Yep.
And how much do you think physical health or the lack thereof, the growing unhealthiness of American men contributes to their ability to do work?
That's a very good question. I don't know that I have a very good answer for it, but it's a very good question. What we've seen over the last 50 years is an almost steady national decline in mortality for both men and women of working ages. That's not the same thing as a decline in morbidity. A decline in death is not the same as a improvement in health, right? So we've had, as you say, we've had the explosion of obesity. We've had the explosion of opioid abuse. We've had a decrease in smoking, which is probably on the plus side. And so how does all of this stuff net out? It's really quite surprising to me, considering that we've got a health sector that spends well over $2 trillion, going on $3 trillion each year. But our life and health sciences have overlooked some very obvious trends in the United States for almost 20 years. One of the trends is the implausible, happy story of Latino health in the United States. When I spent a lot of time in the School of Public Health, and public health students are always trained to be very alert to disparities, not unreasonably. But the Latino story does not match up with the disparity model. Latinos in America, on average, have lower income, lower education, less health insurance. You just go through the list. And their life expectancy is above the national average. And I mean, if you look at Anglos, the non-Hispanic whites, the most healthy Anglos in our country are in Washington, D.C., I guess because they're all lawyers. But you take those Anglos in Washington, D.C., and match them up against Latinos in California, and their life expectancy is lower than Latinos in California. And I don't think all Latinos in California are lawyers. So there's some very good things going on that we don't know why this is happening. There are also some very bad things going on, especially for the Anglos, especially for the non-Hispanic whites, and more so for the less educated ones. From about the late 1990s to the present, there has been a gradual long-term increase in death rates for working-age men and women who are non-Hispanic whites. It needs to be examined much more. Some of this has to do maybe with obesity. Some of it has to do with drugs. Much of it has to do with deaths of despair, suicide, cirrhosis, drugs. One of the things which is really curious is that it took more than a decade and a half to notice this trend in long-term increase in age-standardized mortality for middle-aged Anglos. Can you imagine any other ethnic group in the United States for which a long-term rise in death rates would not be noticed after some number of years, before a decade and a half? This gets back, I guess, a little bit to what happened last year. If people wonder why some people in that group felt that they were overlooked or unprotected, maybe they should ask the public health science people there, too. So thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kara. I go to University of Wisconsin-Madison. My question to you is, my dad's a small business owner, and he's been trying to hire new truck drivers, and throughout this process, he had at least two or three that wanted only benefits and no work. And so he finally had, like, after going through three employees, found one good one. So how, like, in the day of, like, victim mentality, how can the U.S. Kind of encourage more men, especially those with at least one conviction, to join the workforce?
It's a wonderful question, and it's a very, very difficult question to answer. I can mention, there's some things that government can do, there's some things that government should never, ever, ever do, right? So we start with the things that government should never do, but we can think about as private citizens and civil society. One of those has to do with helping stronger families. I hope there will never be a Department of Strengthening Families in Washington, because the inadvertent consequences will be catastrophic. Likewise, I hope there will never be a Department of Religion in our downtown, in the mall. As important as religion is to a strong and vibrant civil society. I mean, these are things which are hard to instrumentalize, but we can recognize them. As far as policy is concerned, two things I would mention. First of all, our disability insurance system is a disaster. It's a shame. It needs to be thoroughly overhauled. The last time we had a real welfare reform that worked in our country, some of you weren't yet born. This was in 1996. During the Clinton administration, when the program of subsidies for single mothers, AFDC, was overhauled. At that time, people said that was going to be a social catastrophe. It was going to end, many people said that. It was going to end as a disaster and great human cost. It turned out to be surprisingly successful. And it turned out actually to be very good for so many of the women who went off welfare and into the working sphere, not least because of what it did for their self-esteem and for their families. We have a system for guys now, for guys who neither work nor look for work, which incentivizes dependence and helplessness through disability insurance, right? And if we had a work first principle in our disability insurance, we would be following in the footsteps of a very successful reform for single mothers. And by the way, single mothers are never idle, right? Whatever else you may say about them, they're always busy. for the guys who are have a felony in their past, I think that this part is really a scandal. I think it is shocking that our government seems so disinterested in the, there are women too, but in the 20 million men and women who've got a felony in their background, you can't find out what their work rates are, you can't find out their income, you can't find out their health, you can't find out what government programs are getting benefits from, you can't find out their living arrangements, you can't find anything out that you'd find out about regular citizens in our country. Until we have evidence, I don't think we can have evidence-based policies for getting people reintroduced into society and into the economy. We can't see what works. If we had that information, I don't think we would solve the problem, but we could take a good whack at it. It's kind of ironic, but nowadays, the people who are in the forefront of dealing with the 20 million invisible Americans are private companies with proprietary data in the big data sector. I'll give you just one example from Uber, okay? So Uber has tried this experiment in a couple of markets. It's taken a couple of thousand ex-con types, or guys with felonies, mainly guys with felonies, some women too, and hired them as drivers. I mean, this is all proprietary, and they do the big data thing, and they're much better with quant stuff than I am. They've got their own algorithms that they won't share with me. I think the basic secret sauce is not hiring violent offenders, but that's just my guess. But to the long story short, their drivers with a complicated past get ratings from customers that are indistinguishable from the other drivers. So that's a huge success. And that's a great way to start repairing people's employment reputation, getting them back mainstreamed. And that's great. Except, you know, so Uber's done this with a couple of thousand drivers. That just leaves 19,990-some thousand others to deal with. If our government would step up to the plate, I'm not suggesting any particular criminal reform, justice reform, prison reform, anything like that. I'm just saying, if our government would simply do what it is supposed to on the minimal night watchman criterion of providing information so that informed citizens can act as an informed citizenry, I think we'd be doing much, much better against this problem than we are today. And we've got a federal system in which we can let 50 flowers bloom and 3,000 counties experiment. And I think before too long, we'd have a pretty good idea about what works and what doesn't, and we'd be way better off than we are now.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all very much. Enjoy your program on the weekend.